Good evening, everyone. Good evening, dear President Engineer KPIU Dharmapala, President-elect Engineer Arjuna Manamperi, past presidents, council members, Dean of Faculty of Engineering, University of Peradeniya, Professor Gamonu Herath, resource person for today's memorial oration, Engineer Nandan Abesuriya, son of late Professor E.O.E. Pereira, Mr. Lawrence Pereira, and other family members, Engineer Lalit Pallegama, Chairman Civil Engineering Sectional Committee, invitees, members of IESL, IESL staff, and other guests. You all are welcome to 34th Memorial Lecture of late Professor E.O.E. Pereira, which is conducted online in this year due to the prevailing situation in the country. By the way, I could see there are some OSIS members also witnessing these proceedings. You all are welcome to this memorial oration as well. To start the event, as we all know that this is an online meeting oration, to start the event, now I cordially invite following distinguished personalities to light the electronic oil lamp symbolically. Engineer KPIU Dharmapala, President IESL, Engineer Arjuna Manamperi, President-elect IESL, two senior-most past presidents, I could see Engineer Priyal De Silva and Engineer LCR De Silva, Engineer Nandana Abesuriya, the speaker, Mr. Lawrence Pereira, son of late Professor E.O.E. Pereira, who is joining from Australia, Professor Gamonu Herath, Dean of Faculty of Engineering, University of Peradeniya, Engineer Lalit Pallegama, Chairman, Civil Engineering Sectional Committee, IESL, and Engineer Neil Abesekara, Chief Executive Officer, Executive Secretary of the IESL. Thank you very much, Jamil, our publicity manager. Now, the next most important event, garlanding the photograph of late Professor E.O.E. Pereira, which is one of the most prominent events of this memorial oration. In order to symbolically garland the photograph, now I respectfully invite President KPIU Dharmapala. Thank you very much, President. In order to give away the welcome address, now I cordially invite our President, Engineer KPIU Dharmapala, to address the gathering. Over to you, sir.
Good evening, everybody. Can you hear me, please?
Yes, Mr. President, we can hear you.
Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the Institution of Engineers Sri Lanka, it is my pleasure to welcome you all for the Professor Engineer E.O.E. Pereira Memorial Oration. As members of not only a learned society, but being grateful people, today we commemorate his 114th birthday. This is a very important event in the IESL annual event calendar. As public gatherings and crossing of district boundaries are prohibited due to prevailing COVID-19 pandemic situation, as our CEO Executive Secretary explained, today we have to conduct this event over Zoom platform. First, I start with our today resource person, Engineer Nandana Abesuriya, Managing Director, NCD Consultants Private Limited, also the President of Society of Structural Engineers Sri Lanka, President-elect Engineer Arjuna Manamperi, Chairman Civil Engineering Sectional Committee, Engineer Lalit Pallegama, family members and relatives of late Professor Engineer E.O. Pereira, past presidents, council members, members of the IESL, other invitees, Executive Secretary, Chief Executive Officer, Engineer Neil Abesekara of the Institute of Sri Lanka. Professor E.O.E. Pereira was born in 13 September 1907 as a Sri Lankan engineer. He played a prominent role in the establishment of the engineering faculty in the University of Ceylon, and he is known as the father of the engineering education in Sri Lanka. Professor E.O.E. Pereira received his education at the Royal College, Colombo, where he excelled in both academics and sports. He won the Disoisa Science Prize, the Muhammad Ali Arithmetic Prize, Evans Prize for Mathematics shared with Nandan D. Obesekara, and he won House Colors for cricket also. The first executive president of Sri Lanka, late J.R. Jayawardena, and Ceylon cricketer N.S. Joseph were his classmates at Royal College. In 1928, he entered the University College Colombo and graduated with a first class honors degree from the University of London, gaining first place in the Faculty of Science and winning the engineering scholarship, where he gained the distinction of being the only graduate to finish the 3-year degree in 2 years, in a 2 years time. His contemporaries at Cambridge University included late one of the prime ministers of Ceylon, Mr. Dudley Sena Nayaka. From the University of Cambridge, he graduated with first class honors in mechanical science, TRIPOS, in 1931. Professor Engineer E.O.E. Pereira served in the Department of Public Works, PWD, for 15 years before joining the teaching staff of the University of Ceylon in 1946. He was its first professor of civil engineering and the founding dean of the engineering faculty, University of Ceylon, at the inception in 1950s. In somewhere around 1967, he converted, I think most of the students who passing out from Peradeniya can remember, in 1970s, when we were students, there was a paddy field in front of this workshop area. Now I think there is a building already they have built up there, that is they use as the library. Then Prime Minister Mr. Dudley Sena Nayaka wanted to launch a Vaga Sangramaya. So Professor E.O. Pereira converted this land, nearly, I think, 2 to 3 acres, using undergraduates to cultivate paddy. And at last he managed to harvest paddy also. So thereafter, in 1969, he was appointed as the Vice Chancellor of the University of Ceylon Peradeniya. He was the chairman of the National Science Council and member of several other government boards and commissions, including the official languages commission and the loans commission. Professor Pereira was honored with the title Vidya Jyoti in 1986. He passed away in 1988. The EOE Pereira Theatre of the Faculty of Engineering, University of Peradeniya, was named to honor him. And several awards are made each year in his name. In ISL level, we are managing to have this EOE Pereira Memorial Oration, and the annual EOE Pereira Memorial Prize that is awarded for the best paper by our institution. Also, the EOE Pereira Gold Medal at the Faculty of Engineering of University also awarded for the graduates. So, once again, with a very warm welcome to all of you, I wish to thank you all for being here with us today for gracing this occasion. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. When you talk about that paddy field story, we could recall some of the photographs shared recently, where one of our past presidents, Madam Ratnayake, Niranjani Ratnayake, was a beautiful young lady at that time. She was, along with her fellow undergraduates, she was planting some paddy plants there. I wonder whether Madam Niranjani Ratnayake is witnessing this event. Okay. Thank you very much once again, President, for your speech. Now the next event is the introduction of the speaker today, Engineer Nandana B. Surya. Now I call upon Engineer Lalit Pallegama, Chairman, Civil Engineering Sectional Committee, to introduce our speaker today. Engineer Pallegama, over to you, sir.
Thank you, Engineer Neil. Good evening to all. As Chairman of Civil Engineering Sectional Committee of ISL, it is a great honor to introduce today's resource person for Professor EOE Pereira Oration. Engineer Nandana B. Surya graduated with Bachelor of Science in Engineering with second class honors, specialized in civil engineering from Faculty of Engineering at University of Peradeniya in 1987. He started his career as an instructor at the Faculty of Engineering and then joined Civil Engineering Central Engineering Consultancy Bureau and worked as at Samanalava Hydroelectric Project for 4 years. After working in both government and private sector for more than a decade, Engineer Nandana established NCD Consultant Private Limited as a startup structural engineering consultancy practice in 1997. NCD is providing structural engineering consultant services for large-scale projects, including high-rise buildings and buildings with deep basement. NCD has extended their services for overseas projects, especially in India, Oman, and Maldives. Engineer Nandana read his master for engineering degree at the University of Moratuwa, specializing in structural engineering design, which he completed in 2005. He obtained his chartered engineer status from the Institute of Engineers Sri Lanka in 1991 and a certified structural engineer authorized to design buildings of more than 20 stories. Engineer Nandana was inducted as a fellow of the Institute of Engineers Sri Lanka in 2009, followed by the International Professional Engineer status in 2010. Moreover, Engineer Nandana currently participates as an exam panel member for high-rise building category registration at ISL and given his services as a panel member for professional review process as well. Also, he contributes to the Construction Industry Development Authority CIDA as a credential committee member. Engineer Nandana representing the industry department industry consultative board for few universities including Peradeniya, Moratuwa, Japan and Sleep. Further, Engineer Nandana is the current president of the Society of Structural Engineers Sri Lanka and the first president of Peradeniya Engineering Faculty Alumni Association, Kalam chapter. With that, I would like to invite Engineer Nandana B. Surya to deliver the memorial lecture. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Engineer Lalit, for your kind introduction. Let me share the presentation first. Okay, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. President of the Institute of Engineers Sri Lanka, Engineer K.P.I.U. Dharmapala, President-elect Engineer Arjuna Manampery, past presidents, members of the council, chairman, Engineer Lalith Pallagama, and the members of the Civil Engineering Sectional Committee, CEO, Engineer Neil Abhishekara, and the staff of ISL. Also the Dean, head of the department, and the staff of Peradeniya Engineering Faculty, Mr. Lawrence Pereira, the friends and relatives of late Engineer Professor E.O. Pereira, members, and all my batchmates representing E82 batch, and dear participants. It is indeed a great honor for nominating me for the Engineer Professor E.O. Pereira Memorial Lecture, and I must show my gratitude to the President and Engineer Lalith Pallagama for recommending me my name for this prestigious annual event. Although we were not fortunate enough to interact with Professor E.O. Pereira, as he was not serving by the time we entered to the faculty in 1982, we enjoy the facilities and influences that he has contributed. We were fortunate to absorb lot from his successors, such as Professor Mahalingam, Professor H.P. De Silva, Professor Ture Raja, Professor Jayasekhar, Professor Gunawardena, Professor Samuel, Professor C.L. Vijayadilaka, Professor Milton Amaradunga, Professor Ranaveera, who work with the same spirit. Professor Pereira, as President also explained in his speech, initially planned 120 intakes against 25, which was the demand. However, during our time, the intake was 250, and 1,000 students utilized the facilities without even feeling that there are so much in this man-made paradise. Professor Pereira has even gone to an extent of thinking the climatic conditions of Peradeniya by providing corridors linking all the lecture halls. So I'm sure even with the few additions to the faculty, the current students' intake is managed comfortably. So it shows how such a visionary leader Professor E.O. Pereira is. So obviously the Institute of Engineers in return pay tributes to this father of modern education for engineers in Sri Lanka by way of conducting this Professor Engineer Professor E.O. Pereira Memorial Oration. Today, as all of you know, we have faced a big challenge as a country and need more visionary leaders like Professor Ture Raja if you want to see the light at the end of this tunnel. So let me start my presentation. The topic, as all of you know, is effective use of Sri Lankan timber for sustainable constructions. The overview of the presentation, I hope all of you can see my presentation. The introduction, history of timber construction in Sri Lanka, then timber as a sustainable construction material, carbon cycle and sequestration, embodied energy, limitations in the use of timber for construction, effective use of timber in the construction industry, use of local timber effectively in the construction industry, and finally, the use of timber connections. Okay. Timber is nothing new for us, and timber is the only building material on earth which naturally renewable, recyclable, and leaves a lighter footprint than any other. In its production, the embodied energy in wood is a fraction of energy required to produce almost any other building material. So I think the message that we should take today is the embodied energy in timber or wood is a fraction of energy required to produce almost any other building materials. We have been using timber for centuries, and we are simply using other materials without considering this important factor. I think all of you know our history. The Warich walls we have seen even in our younger days, the Warich walls and the roof. Because in good olden days, timber was one of the important material and one of the popular material for people, and stone was there only for palaces and stupas. The poor people used timber and stone, and that is the reason why there is no footprint of any, there is no trace of any material they used. So it shows how sustainable material the timber is. So as I said earlier, the timber was the first construction material, and it was used not only for houses, it was used for bridges, it was used for warships, and many more applications were done with the timber. The history of timber construction in Sri Lanka, I am sure all of you have seen these structures. This picture itself explains how good we were in the use of timber. This Bogota Bridge on the left-hand corner top, you can still see. Well, what is the secret between timber and other materials? Timber never perish under favorable conditions. So you can see this timber, how many, I'm sure you can guess the age of this timber. When the timber is under favorable condition, it never perish. So that is the reason why we can still see this timber. And we were very good in using timber for many construction works. And we are quite familiar with the timber. Not only timber for construction, it is for furniture, for household tools. We have made tools out of timber. So, I mean, it is not a new subject for us. Let me explain a couple of definitions so that we understand better about the lecture today. What is sapwood and hardwood? This picture shows sapwood and hardwood. This is sapwood, and the one in the center is the hardwood. It is not hardwood, hardwood. The sapwood is a medium for transporting food. When the tree is growing, the sapwood is a media which transport food to the leaves and the branches. And hardwood is the center area. And our ancient carpenters knew hardwood is durable because there is no food in the hardwood. The wood borer attacks are always happening in the sapwood because you still find food in the sapwood. But there is no food in the hardwood, so there is no attack to the hardwood. So all the durable structures, our ancient carpenters use the hardwood only. There's another two terms, that is softwood and hardwood. So we should understand what is softwood and hardwood. So soft, by name says, softwood is like a low density, and hardwood has high density. And if I go back to the previous slide, the strength wise, the sapwood and hardwood are the same. So this is where my question arises, have we used TIMB effectively? I'm talking about our history. If the strength of Saput and Hawk are same, have we used TIMB effectively? The answer is no, because we are using the hardwood. And when there are softwood and hardwood, again, we use only hardwood. We didn't use softwood for obvious reasons, such as the durability, then wood borer attacks and all. Let me come to item three, and then we can discuss more about the softwood and hardwood. The timber taken from well-managed forests is the most sustainable construction material, as I said earlier. It has minimum or no effect on the environment when disposed of as construction waste, because the timber perishes and leave no traces. The most attractive feature in the structural timber is the high strength to weight ratio of timber, which can be used to transfer tension, compression, and shear. If you take, for example, concrete is very good in compression, but very poor in tension. But timber is good in both tension and compression. So that is one of the interesting property of timber. So therefore, engineers, architects, and builders consider timber as one of the best material for the construction industry. And it has unique characteristics such as the natural grain patterns, colors, and color variation, fine finishes, and the various features of species. Nowadays, we consider timber as a luxurious material. You have seen a lot of replication of timber elements out of concrete and aluminium, because people think timber is more expensive than the other materials. Is that correct? Now, as all of you know, as part of the process of photosynthesis, the trees give off oxygen and absorb carbon dioxide from the air and air and sequester it in woody tissues. So as to produce 1 kilo of wood, a tree takes 1.47 kilograms of CO2 and return 1.07 kilograms of oxygen to the atmosphere. So that is the very important factor that we should not forget. So the forestation is very important. Somebody might ask, if timber is a sustainable material, what will happen if you cut all the timbers? We'll be end up with the deserts. So that's a good question. But timber is sustainable material provided that we do reforestation and replantation. I am just showing two maps of Sri Lanka, the forest cover in 1956 and forest cover in 1999. So we can see the difference. This is because we have used our timber, of course, not effectively, and we have not done the reforestation or replantation. This is where the timber prices has gone up. Before we go into the topic of effective use, let's compare timber with other materials so that we'll understand in terms of the sustainability, how timber is suitable for construction. The most energy used in the production of building material is derived from fossil fuels, and embodied energy is a significant indicator of a material's impact on the carbon cycle. As timber and other forest products are largely made from atmospheric carbon, they don't have the same relationship between embodied energy and the carbon cycle as other major building materials. Generally, the embodied energy measure the total energy used to transform raw materials into ready-to-use building products. So, for example, if you are making bricks at one place, the embodied energy means not only manufacturing bricks, it includes transport also. So you need fossil fuels to transport. So your total embodied energy, consider the total manufacturing and transport to the required destinations. So embedded energy includes the energy required to obtain raw materials, process them, and produce the building material, the energy used in transporting the material, and the energy used in construction. So once it is transported, you have to construct it also. For example, if you are talking about the aluminium product, you have to get the raw material, you have to process, you have to transport, and then you have to fabricate also. So the total is cost, the total embedded energy. Now we see this chart for us to get some idea about the fossil fuel and fossil fuel energy. The rough sawn timber, it is 1.5 megajoules per kilogram when it is 435 megajoules per kilogram. You see, now we are conveniently using aluminium windows against the timber windows. But see the difference between the energy consumption, or rather the fossil fuel usage for sawn timber and aluminium. Concrete is better compared to aluminium and steel, but steel is also much high. But see these factors. So I think these are the important factors that we should consider before we take some decisions. And also CO2 release. Are we storing carbon from other materials? The answer is no. The timber releasing of carbon so much, only 30 per ton, kilograms per ton, when steel require 700 kilograms per ton. Concrete production release 50 kilograms of carbon per ton, and aluminium is releasing 8,700 kilograms per ton. So all these tables will show you the difference between timber and the other construction materials. So lot of research are done on the comparison of all these materials. One says, some research says the steel beam require more than 10 times the production energy of the equivalent timber beam. If you are going to replace a timber beam of your house with a steel beam, remember the steel beam require more than 10 times the production energy. So brick cladding for houses also use significantly more energy than wood cladding. I think you have seen in a lot of European countries, they use timber claddings. And for certain reasons, we don't use much in Sri Lanka. But even when you compare the timber wood cladding with brick, still brick claddings are using more energy than cladding. And aluminium windows, 50 times. So when you compare a window frame and an aluminium frame, especially our consultants, keep this in mind. The energy consumption is 50 times more. And I mean, there are limitations, especially for high-res buildings. We can't use timber windows. So there are limitations. But wherever possible, remember, keep this as a plus factor when you have to select one out of that. And when considering the air pollution, solid waste management, and energy required for the construction using above material is considered, timber is the right choice for to use wherever possible. So considering all the factors I described, timber is the right choice if you are thinking of sustainability. Okay. Now, what are the limitations? Although timber is the most sustainable material, are we using timber wherever required? The answer is no, because there are limitations. What are those limitations? Because timber is a natural material. So, now if you consider concrete structure, If you are having a building of 100 square meters or 1,000 square meters, even 100,000 square meters, so the dimensions are not a problem as long as the other factors are satisfied. But in case of timber, if you need a single column, let's say 6 meter, we have to cut a tree and get a 6 meter column. But if it is a concrete, you can cast concrete. Even steel, you get steel sections up to 12 meter. That's because of the transporting limitations. So when you use timber, steel and concrete, these dimensions are not major concerns. And also, if you need a, I'm giving an example of a timber column. If suppose you need a, let's say, 1 foot by 1 foot, let's say 200 by 200 millimeter column of 6 meter height, you have to cut either one big tree or sometimes the complete tree is required to get this column. So because of that reason, compared to the cost of other materials, timber is very expensive. So these are the costs has been the main reason for not using timber as construction material in the construction industry. Otherwise, a lot of people prefer to use timber columns, timber arches, timber beams for their houses. The cost has made all the limitations. Okay, if there's a limitations, now there should be a solution also. The solution is built up timber. Just like you connect steel columns, steel beams, and making large span factory buildings, or even bridges, you can do the same thing with timber also by using built up timber. You can see this, if you see this picture, this is not one full tree. So it has taken pieces and connected. And if you further study, these are not solid timber as well. So that's why the built up timber has become very cost effective and popular in the construction industry. Because you are getting the maximum use of a tree when you cut a tree. You are getting the maximum use of the tree and you can make elements of required spans and required height and length by using this built-up timber concept. So let's talk more about the built-up timber concept because it's going to be the cost-effective solution. So this is a nice structure done out of small timber elements. But using the small timber elements like other steel structures, you are making large structures effectively. Now in the international arena, although which are not very popular in Sri Lanka, these three type of timber products are very popular. One is the cross-laminated timber, CLT. Other one is laminated veneer lumber, LVL, and glue lamp beams. Because you take small timber sections and make larger elements, and therefore the cost is very effective. And you can do the same structures, even more beautiful structures, using timber than the other construction materials. What is cross-laminated timber? The cross-laminated timber is actually we take solid members and glue it in orthogonal directions. Like I think I'm sure all of you have seen plywood, how the plywood is made. That is, we are gluing layers in the two opposite directions, orthogonal directions, and making a plywood. So this CLT is also the same process, but you are using bigger sections. You can see this, the timber panels, are you using as flow boards. In this house, you can see in this building, these flow boards are done out of CLT. So this is how you may make this CLT. And if I just further explain, the cross-laminated timber is defined as a prefabricated solid engineered wood. All these are engineered wood products made of at least 3 orthogonally bonded layers of solid sawn timber. So the difference is we are using solid sawn timber and laminating, you are making various kind of timber elements. You can use for walls, you can use for floor, you can use for roof. So even in this building, the lift shaft has done out of CLT. Other one is laminated veneer lumber, LVL. So the difference of this LVL is we are fixing laminated veneer lumber is a layered composite of wood veneer and adhesive. LVL is basically you are the difference is you are having in the same direction, the same layers. You can see you make even larger portal roof beams out of this thin wood layers. The difference is this has parallel lamination. In the previous case, we were fixing them in orthogonal direction, but in LVL, we are doing a parallel lamination and making large structures. Other one is glued laminated timber, like you know this arch shape. You can make any possible shapes out of small sections. You can join them. You don't want a long beam like this. You can even get small sections and join them and get a required shape. You can see even these arches, the domes, are done out of glue lam beam. You call glue lam beam, that is glue laminated beams, which is a very cost-effective system. So unfortunately, we are not seeing these three products in Sri Lanka. So the reason is could be no one has still invested on this project. I have heard some companies have already started producing these type of elements, but it has not gone much into the construction industry. But according to them, they say it is feasible. Even making large beams out of them, they have the technology, they have the machinery, and they are ready to produce similar, you know, any kind of members in Sri Lanka. But unfortunately, we are not aware of this, the availability of this technology and the productions. Okay, I think this one, of course, we all know. This the truss beams, we have seen truss beams in our schools, we have seen truss beams. So this is a beautiful example of built up timber. You are making large trusses out of small sections. If you are supposed to use one single beam instead of the truss, can you guess the cost difference? You can see even in a 3D image, you can make very beautiful structures, permanent structures, temporary structures with this truss beam, which is not new for us. So we are using steel trusses as well as timber trusses. And transporting is easy because you are transporting small pieces. The cost of transport is very less. So if I recall this embedded energy, the embedded energy in this element is very low because you make small sections, so wastage is minimum. The transport cost is less because you bring all the stuff together and connect at the site. And our carpenters are very good doing this type of work. They know very advanced technology involved. You as engineers, we have to design the most cost-effective designs and give the best optimum sizes and connection detail. People can make these trusses very easily. And I think the top example is also a parallel coated truss. this was used many years ago in a house where the roof has sagged. The house was with the top member and roof has sagged because obviously the section size is small. So my solution was to create a truss. I think we are all engineers, we know by making this section, the amount of inertia of the section is increased and you have to jack it and then provide this truss and make this roof again straight. I'm sure this is again one that we use for house. The owner is also participating from, I think, Australia. So this is again another example of a timber truss. If we replace this with the solid timber beam, you have to use a fairly big section. Now this has done, you can guess the span, this has done with 2x4, two timber sections. The cost is only a fraction when you compare the cost of a solid beam. Another option is a space beam. I'm actually talking something which are feasible for our country. Now, if you consider this beam, if you use a solid beam and the cost is very high because the length is more than 7 meters. So getting a solid beam of 7 meter long is very expensive. So sometimes you will go for a concrete beam or a steel beam. But now the solution we have provided is more cheaper than all the other options. You have made the space beam by connecting two timber sections with a spacer. And even you can make joints also. You don't want one single beam of 7 meter. You can join them at various places which are not critical for tension and compression and also bending. So the space beam is a good looking element which even the architects also accept. Now this is another space beam which I have used at my residence. This is more than 20 feet, 6 meter. So the top one is 100 by 150 and bottom also 100 by 150 section with a spacing of 150. So the spaces are provided at 600 centers so that it will be in line with the rafter spacing. So can you guess the cost difference of using this against a solid beam? Because sometimes the solid beam, now in the structural design, we consider two things. One is the capacity, flexural capacity. Other one is the deflection. So sometimes even the capacity is fine, you still have deflection. So you can't have a deflected roof. So therefore we have to go unnecessarily a higher section because it should control the deflection. I will go to next slide. Now, these are the simple calculation of the space beam I showed you. This is a 6 meter beam, as I said earlier. The top bottom sections are 100 by 150 with a spacing of 150. So if you take a section, any section here, you know there'll be bending. So bending is taken by tension and compression. If it is a simply supported beam, the bottom you'll have tension, you have compression at top. I did a small calculation just to show you, just to compare the space beam against a solid beam. So if I take two sections of 100 by 150, the total area is 30,000 millimeter squared. So the amount of inertia of this section with a 150 spacer beam is this much. So if I find a equivalent solid beam with the width of same 100 and the depth is D, you will know, you will get D as 443.3 millimeter and the area is 44,400. Just compare these two figures. If I use a space beam, the projectional area of the timber is 30,000. If I use an equivalent solid beam, the projectional area is 44,400. So you can see the area is also more. And also, as all of us have at least purchased timber from anyway. We know the section, when the section increases, it is not proportional. If a 100 by 50 section is, let's say, 1,000 rupees, 100 by 300 section is not 2,000 rupees. It is even 5,000 rupees, because to cut a 100 by 300 section, you have to waste a lot of timber. So therefore, the area wise is so high, and also the cost is very high. And I have done a small calculation, just simple calculation, to check the moment capacity of this solid beam and the space beam. And the space beam has a higher moment capacity. So this simple example show you the space beam is much more cost effective, and also it is more stronger. It resists for the deflection and moment capacities. So a simple example, the other one is the box beams. Now we are talking about the trusses, we are talking about the space beam, the other one is a box beam. You can make a box section out of thin timber layers, timber planks. What is the difference between box beam and a solid section? The answer is the box section has a higher moment of inertia in both the direction. So when you have a beam, basically a beam has bending and torsion. So if you have box section, which is ideal for both bending and torsion. So if I get the equivalent solid section, I mean the total equal cross-sectional area, the moment of inertia of the solid section is very much smaller than the box section. So that explain you that box section perform much better than a solid beam, and it is cost effective. And they know rocket science, you can simply make these beam sections. And you can see this box section can be used for large spans in structures, because the box section has a strong resistance for torsion as well as bending, and you can handle it, because timber is always lighter than the other construction material like steel and concrete. The handling cost is also very less. Okay. We have seen concrete I-beams in bridges and steel I-beams in steel buildings. So what is the advantage of going for a I-beam compared to a solid beam? I'm sure all of you know the answer, because the I-beam has a higher section modulus for the amount of inertia. So that's why we go for I-beams, concrete beams, and steel beams. Okay, that is fine. So why can't we use that with timber also? So the same principle. Now when our contractors, I'm sure the contractors are represented today, when they want to do formwork where you can't provide props at a close intervals. Suppose there is a driveway to be provided for various reasons, you need to have beams which can span. So we go for either steel sections or solid timber sections. Now, at a site, you get enough once-use plywood. So for temporary construction, you can use those once-use plywood and make I-beams. All that you need is two by twos, top and bottom, and make an I-beam. So you have to design and use it. By designing, you can use the most optimum section, but understanding the properties of timber, we can use it. For example, now if you the simple principle in I-beam is the moment capacity is taken by the top and bottom flanges, and the web is taking the shear. So we are near the support, you can even increase the thickness by adding another plywood to increase the shear. So I mean, there are ways and means of increasing the capacity of an I-beam with a waste material. This is for formworks and other works. But you can see this picture shows how the I-beams are used for supporting formwork. You can fabricate the beams at site and use effectively, cost effectively. Okay, there's another option called layered beam. The layered beam is you are gluing layers, timber layers. Can you see this layer beam where the top and bottom members are dark and the middle area is lighter? What could be the reason? So simply layered beams, because here again, we are taking small sections, gluing them together and making a bigger beam. So obviously, your section is cheaper than a equivalent solid beam. If somebody doesn't like to use I-beam or a space beam, you can still have a solid beam. If architect insists that you have a solid beam, you can still go for a solid beam by gluing layers, timber layers, and which is very cost effective. Now, we know a simple bending theory. If there's a beam subject to bending, you'll have a higher stress at the extreme fiber. So if you are using a timber beam, now if I am asked to design a timber solid timber beam, I will check the bending parallel to grain. I'm checking the maximum stress at the top or bottom fiber and design for that. But that is a waste, because the middle zone is not really taking that much of load, but we are still providing the similar timber. So that's why now in the layered section, you can use, depending on the stress, this diagram, you can point higher density, strong timber for top and bottom, which has higher tension parallel to grain and compression parallel to grain. And the middle zone, you can use a soft timber. So this is a very cost-effective solution. Now, at the first couple of slides, I talk about the softwood and hardwood, not sapwood and hardwood, softwood and hardwood. Now you see, now here, we can use hardwood for the top and bottom layers and softwood for the middle layers. So that is another way of using the timber effectively. Box column. Again, if you need columns, solid column, as I say, explained at the beginning, you've got a big tree to get a solid column. That's why people are not willing to use solid timber. So they go for concrete and other products. But don't go for those products. If you like to see a timber column at your place, go for a timber box column. I think the best example of the box column, the structural behavior is a bamboo tree. Bamboo tree has a higher flexural capacity because it has higher moment of inertia and section modulus because of this natural shape. So similarly, we can get a more strong. This is good for buckling as well, because basically columns are subject to compression and slim columns are buckling, as we all know. So let's go for a box column, which is cheaper and strong. This is again a lattice column. This was done in Sri Lanka. The architect was a Sri Lankan architect called Hiranti Velendal. And engineer Saravira Sura and I myself joined, we work on this. You can see the height of this column compared to the height of the man. This entire column was done with 2x4 timber sections. So this is a bit of a complicated lattice column, but you can have parallel corded lattice columns. you can go even for box shaped lattice columns. I mean, up to you to agree on a shape, because you all are, we are all engineers. We can discuss with the architects and go for more suitable lattice columns. If you want to see a lot of lighter view, you don't want sort of bulky features, you can go for a lattice column, which serve the same purpose. Okay. Now the problem is, are we having enough timber in Sri Lanka? Or are we using local timber? Now we discuss few examples where we discuss columns, beams, even slabs, we can use timber for your building construction, permanent construction, temporary construction. But are we having enough timber? Or are we using our timber effectively? Because we know we import timber from Malaysia. And when we import timber from Malaysia, we have to ship it. So a lot of fossil fuel uses. And obviously the embedded energy in the timber increases. So transport has to be the minimum if you want to make the structures more sustainable. So ideally we had to use our own timber. And under the history of and our Sri Lankan history, I showed you sapwood and hardwood, softwood and hardwood. So just like we did not use sapwood, we didn't use softwood also. We only use hardwood. Now the trend is to use both softwood and hardwood for construction industry, for temporary and permanent structures. We call light density timber, medium density timber, and high density timber. So let's see. Now you can see the locally available timber and their densities. So we call light density when the density is less than 500 kilograms per square meter. So some of the light density timber are Albizia, Lunumedella, Ratamba, Aju, Tuna, Cypress, Pine. Right. Now these timber are coming under light density timber. Then the moderately heavy density timber is between 500 and 650. Rubber, pine, mahogany, grandis, jack, mango, ginisapu, savuku. Now you see all these timbers are available in this country. And now we are using rubber effectively. Rubber is a high density, moderately heavy density timber. We know we use treated rubber for furniture. We use mahogany, of course, again for furniture. Grandis is somewhat used for roof structures and all. Jack, of course, the cost is very high. We don't use mango. We don't use ginisapu. We don't use sabuku. Although the densities are high, the reason is the durability issue. Because the good borer attacks are happening and all. So we can use treated timber. The treated timber, if you treat, we can use for durable structures. Because our attitude has to be changed. We must understand that the treated timber lasts long and we can use for permanent structures. The life of a structure is about 50 years. And even if we are having this sustaining for 50, that should be more than sufficient. But we know our experience, our timber can last more than that. And these are actually heavy density timber, more than 650. All these timbers are available, teak, kansuria, Estonia. So So where is the, what has really happened to us when we have so much of timber having higher densities, medium density, and they are good for construction, we are still not using it. Because we don't know that we can use them. That is the first issue. So we have to understand soft timber also can be used for permanent structures, but more than the soft timber, the medium density and heavy density timbers are recommended for permanent structures, and you leave the other timber for furniture and other uses. Nowadays, we are using the most strong timber for furniture. Whereas the soft timber can be used for furniture, because furniture, as you know, are not taking higher load. So we should not waste our strong timber for kind of furniture, pantry cupboards and other stuff. But for roof structures, timber flooring, we can use high density timbers after doing providing the treatments. So we know when you fly over Malaysia, you can see the forest cover. But Malaysia is the country which is producing the maximum timber. The Malaysia is producing timber for the entire Asian region. But you can still see the forest cover. That is because of the replantation. Now we have in Sri Lanka, we have enough lands. Even if you go to Eastern Province, Northern Province, in other areas, you have enough lands. But we don't do it. That is because we are not concentrating. We are not focusing on planting fast grown medium density timber. So that is what we should focus, because using medium density timber, within 10 years you can harvest it, and you can use for many structural applications. That is good enough for any kind of structural applications, and which grow very fast. So we have to use medium density timber rather than planning for high density timber, which take so many years to grow. Okay, so I think we discussed about the timber, the type of elements we can use effectively, and also about the available timber in Sri Lanka, and finally the connections. The timber has to be connected finally to fabricate any shapes of structures. So there are a lot of connections. You could, I think, as all of you know, we have nail connections. We can use adhesives. We can use both. And our engineers, as engineers, we have to design the connections. So that is where it is important. Even a roof structure, if you design, if you know the properties and if you design, then you can use the timber effectively. A lot of people think that we engineers don't design timber. When I was doing a presentation sometimes back at Jayawardenepura University, when I was talking about the technical properties and the design details, one of the expert in forest, this thing asked, are you really designing timber? I said, yes. He has thought that we don't do any designs, like the basuna has, we just give sizes. So that has to be changed. We should design timber sections. We can analyze them because they know complicated analytical this thing involved. You can simply analyze and see the forces and then design the sections, the most cost-effective sections. And this is how you do make box sections. You see this connection is very simple. This is a box section, this is a layered column, this is a space column, this is a lattice column. You can see in the elevation, lattice column, space column, layered column, box column. Just by glue, nailing. And this is some of the box column we tested at Monroe University when I was doing my master's with under the supervision of Dr. Mrs. Hettiarachchi. So this simple test using local glue. Now somebody may question that we don't have adhesives. The expensive adhesives are not available. So how can we use adhesive for structural members? Actually, this local airable adhesives are very good, and that is good enough for our purposes. This is an example of connecting a space beam, the truss beam or a space beam. These are real applications in Sri Lanka. So it is possible. Our carpenters can make these sections very easily. You will have to only give the details and know-how. So this is of course testing of samples for adhesives. So the adhesives perform very well under very different conditions. And also, I think, you know, adhesives, most of the adhesives are petroleum-based adhesives, but people are now researching on the use of bio-based wood adhesives, which is more sustainable. And that's all about my presentation. So the final message I want to make today is try to use effective timber sections rather than solid timber, because the same elegance can be maintained with even with the built timber. That is the real sustainable timber, and promote replantation, reforestation, and use not high density timber but medium density timber effective for our construction works. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Engineer Nandana Abhay Surya, for your highly informative but somewhat challenging speech on the effective use of timber. We could see many questions in the chat box. Probably you may be able to answer them. We may send them to you by the administrator or the host of this event.
Yeah,
Now next action is basically to electronically present you the token of appreciation. It is ready, but we are not able to in a position to hand it over. But to present it to you electronically, I invite President Engineer KPIU Dharmapala to hand it over to you. It's a gesture, like.
Thank you, Engineer Dharmapala. I think the best gift is nominating me for this prestigious lecture. That is the best gift. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, President and Mr. Abhay Surya. Finally, to wind up the session, let me invite Engineer Chaminda Jayasinghe, the Deputy Chairman of Civil Engineering Sectional Committee, to deliver the vote of thanks. Engineer Chaminda Jayasinghe, podium is for you.
Okay, thank you, Engineer Neil. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you very okay. Well.
President of IESL, and President-elect, past presidents, and all council members, Engineer Nandana Abhay Surya, our resource person today, and Executive Secretary of IESL, and family members, friends of Professor E.O.I. Pereira, and my dear fellow engineers and ladies and gentlemen. It's a great privilege for me to give a vote of thanks in this occasion. First of all, I should thank Engineer Nandana Abhay Surya for delivering a valuable lecture with important topic. In nowadays, many of our engineers trying to adapt, rather I must say need to be adapt sustainable methodology in our construction practices. thank you, Engineer Nandana Abhisuria, you have great presentation with valuable messages. And then we wish bright future for giving more valuable inputs to the engineering society. Then I should thank family members and friends of late Professor E.O.I. Pereira, including Mr. Lawrence Pereira. Now he is today online join with us. Then I should thank both President and President-elect of ISL, Engineer K.P.U.I.U. Dharmapala and Engineer Arjuna Manampiri for valuable guidance for success this event. Then I should thank all of academic staff members from University of Peradeniya, including Professor Gamunu Heran. They actually joining today event. Then I must thank all members of civil engineering and structural community, including Chairman Civil Engineer Lalit Palegama. Then I should appreciate the work done by all secretariat staff members, including Engineer Neil, Executive Secretary of IASL. Finally, I should thank all participants. Today, I think nearly 300 members participated this event. So all the engineers, fellow engineers, I wish you all healthy and safe future and stay safe. Good night. Thank you.